Good morning. So good to see you on this beautiful Lord's Day morning. Thank you for coming. I want to extend a special welcome to our visitors, as we always do. We're honored to have you with us, and we hope the Lord gives you a significant blessing today for being with God's people in this house. A couple of announcements just to remind us of some things. Choir rehearsal today from 4 to 5. If you have not been a part of our choir, Mr. Stiegel would love to have you join and come and enjoy the fellowship of that group, who will minister to us in a few moments. The Abiders meeting has been canceled for this month. You can see also our next life groups start on the 12th, and we also have three of them on the 15th. I would remind everybody that we do have an ongoing Wednesday fellowship. There's a coffee and prayer time at the home of Larry Loftus, and that meets any of the Wednesdays when we don't have our regular life groups. Larry graciously opens his home for people to come and have a time of prayer and coffee. There's always good coffee, usually something sweet to nibble on, and that's good too. Further, I want to make an observation about our worship today. We're going to sing today. We sing every Sunday, right? I'm asking, encouraging that we sing with exuberance. Now, not every song we sing here is a foot-stomping Grand Ole Opry kind of song. I get that. We have songs that are contemplative. We have songs that are sometimes even mournful. Even the mournful song should be sung with exuberance. I'm encouraging us to really sing out and praise the Lord with our voices today. The choir is going to show us how to do that in just a moment when they come for a call to worship. And I hope we follow that up with good, solid, just exuberant praise of our Lord Jesus Christ through our singing. And I hope that holds true for all the aspects of our service here, that we've come to worship the Lord. In our Sunday school classes, we had an example of the extravagant worship of Mary of Bethany, who anointed the Lord from head to foot with a precious oil and was criticized because it was too much. Let us be criticized because our worship is too much. All right? With that encouragement, I'm going to ask the choir to come and lead us, and we're going to sing in an exuberant manner, and they're going to show us how.
Stand and praise our God.
be seated.
Let's pray. Father, we come before you acknowledging your holiness. And we confess, Father, that we are not, apart from the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the righteousness we claim through him and him alone. And Father, we exalt you for your perfections, that you are perfect in love, perfect in mercy, perfect in grace, that you are altogether holy and righteous and good and true, and we worship you. Father, we thank you for the Holy Spirit, God the Spirit who indwells us, and I pray that God the Holy Spirit, by his grace and mercy, would open our minds and hearts to the Word of God, that we might see great things about you, that we might learn how to live lives of holiness and righteousness as well. And we thank you for the Lord Jesus Christ. We thank you that by him all things consist. We thank you that he is the fullness of the Godhead bodily. And we thank you that he is King of kings and Lord of lords. And yet he is our faithful and compassionate and concerned high priest who feels our every need and takes our every need before the throne of grace. And he pleads the blood and he shows the wounds that indicate that we are his and he is ours. And Father, we pray that in this service we might see Jesus Christ afresh. We pray that we might see him anew. We pray that we might see him with eyes of faith and rejoice in what we have in Christ. And Father, we thank you for the gospel, how simple it is. And we beg you, Father, to give us that childlike faith to trust you and help us to trust you even when we don't understand. Now, Father, we commit every aspect of this service to you. We pray that with boldness we will come before your throne of grace and that we will come before you with great praises and great singing and great exaltation and humble our hearts and quiet our minds and open us, Father, that we might be filled. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Stand and continue our worship.
Rescue the souls of men. Oh.
with our voices.
You are the one that we raise. You are the one we adore. You give the healing and grace. Hearts always hunger. Oh, our hearts always hunger.
Let's pray together. Lord in heaven, we thank you so much for your bountiful blessings to White Oak. We thank you that in mid-March 1895, a small group of women and a few men joined together under a White Oak tree and started this church. 128 years. Lord, your blessings, your grace, your kindness, your forgiveness, your long-suffering, patient mercy has been shown towards this small, sometimes large, sometimes small flock. We thank you, O Lord, for your blessings, for the graces, the mercies. These things inspire us and sustain us. Lord, we thank you for the many generations of faithful givers who by your grace have given to the church, have given to missions, have sustained the ministry financially. We pray, God, that we also, in our own turn, would obediently and graciously give. We thank you for the way you've met our needs recently, Lord, bringing us a pastor to continue in the ministry of the word, bringing us new members to encourage us and to strengthen us and to fellowship with us. We thank you, Lord, that as we look to the future, we don't have a spirit of human fear, but of power, of love, and of a sound mind. We think of the power of fellowship and worship. We think of the love that we have for each other, Lord, the blessings of encouraging each other and living life together. And we thank you of the sound thinking that will lead us into the future and by your grace sustain us for many more years. Lord, please bless the offering as we give it this week. Bless our time of contemplation around the gifts that you've given to us and the gifts that we share with the church. We thank you for all these things in Christ's name. Amen.
Thank you. As we continue our reading through the Gospel of John, hear the word of the Lord. After the 2 days, he, Jesus, departed for Galilee, for Jesus himself had testified that a prophet has no honor in his own hometown. So when he came to Galilee, the Galileans welcomed him, having seen all that he had done in Jerusalem at the feast, for they too had gone to the feast. So he came again to Cana in Galilee, where he had made the water wine. And at Capernaum, there was an official whose son was ill. And when this man heard that Jesus had come from Judea to Galilee, he went to him and asked him to come down and heal his son, for he was at the point of death. So Jesus said to him, "Unless you see signs and wonders, you will not believe." The official said to him, "Sir, come down before my child dies." And Jesus said to him, "Go, your son will live." The man believed the word that Jesus had spoke to him and went on his way. And as he was going down, his servants met him and told him that his son was recovering. So he asked them the hour when he began to be better, to get better. And they said to him, "Yesterday at the seventh hour, the fever left him." And the father knew that was the hour when Jesus said to him, "Your son will live." And he himself believed, and all his household. This was now the second sign that Jesus did when he had come from Judea to Galilee. Thanks be to God for his word.
Trumpet sounds within my soul. I ain't got long to stay here. Steal away, steal away, steal away to Jesus. Away home, I ain't got long to stay here. Green trees are bending, poor sinner stands a trembling. The trumpet sounds within my soul. I ain't got long to stay here. Steal away, steal away, steal away to Jesus. Steal away, steal away home. I ain't got long to stay here,
by fear and find love with you.
Turn, please, in your Bible to Deuteronomy chapter 2. Deuteronomy chapter 2. Like you, I'm sure, I have some favorite spots I like to visit. One of those places is Washington, D.C. My wife and I, and sometimes our entire family, have gone to the nation's capital. I love the mall. I love all the museums. Of all the museums that I love the National Gallery of Art. It's a wonderful place. I love the architecture of the building. I love the beauty of the rooms. And of course, I love the art on display. It has a special place for us in our hearts, for Margaret and me. We celebrated our 25th anniversary in Washington, D.C. And after a long day of walking and walking and walking, our anniversary's on June 1st, by the way, we're walking, walking, walking. Washington is hot, hot, hot. It's getting tired. And I say, we got one more stop to make. Margaret's like, please, can we just go back to the room? No more, no more. So we went to the National Gallery, not inside, but near their front steps, there's this huge, huge basin. Perhaps you're familiar with that. I think there's more than one of them. So we sat down by that, and then I gave her the diamond ring that I couldn't afford 25 years earlier. What a guy. What a guy. And she was quite appreciative of that. But I love the gallery for the art itself. I'm particularly drawn to the Impressionists. I don't know why. I love the Impressionists. I mean, I just gaze at them. Or you'll go in the National Gallery and there'll be an entire room of Van Gogh. It's just beautiful to be there. But sometimes we also enjoy great music. I hope you do. I suppose of the classical composers, my favorite would be Beethoven. I know very little about music per se, but I've always been so impressed with his symphonies and the great works. And have you ever been moved by a building that when you come and see the architecture of the building, it is so beautiful, it is scaled so perfectly, it is designed so well that it seems to grow out of the area in which it's planted? And sometimes even in cultures that we would consider perhaps pagan, certainly not Christian cultures, you can go to a place like India and you can see the Taj Mahal. And it's an astounding thing to see. It's beautiful. It's breathtaking. We have a passage in the book of Acts that I find very interesting. In chapter 17, we have the recounting of the story of Paul on Mars Hill, in which he is interacting with the philosophers on Mars Hill in the first century. And in part of Paul's message to them, beginning of verse 24 of Acts 17, he makes some observations. The God who made the world and everything in it, being Lord of heaven and earth, does not live in temples made by man, nor is he served by human hands as though he needed anything, since he himself gives to all mankind life and breath and everything. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on all the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and the boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. Yet he is actually not far from each one of us, for in him we live and move and have our being. This is a quote, we believe, from Epimenides of Crete, an ancient Greek writer. Not a Christian, and Paul is not quoting Scripture. As even some of your own poets have said, for we are indeed his offspring. This is a very direct quote from Erato's poem, Phenomena. So Paul, in establishing this truth, goes about establishing the truth by quoting famous poets that these philosophers would have been aware of. and would have quoted themselves. Another intriguing passage that you can quote, many of you by heart, and was alluded to in song already here, is Philippians 2 and verse 8. Finally, brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is honorable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence, if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Now, some would argue that those terms do not refer to that which is in our world, but must refer specifically to Jesus Christ himself. I don't think that that interpretation holds water. I think Paul says what he means here. If you look about you and you see things that are beautiful, you see things that are true, and they're honorable, and they're just, and they're pure, and they're lovely, if they're at all commendable, think on these things. And an even perhaps more intriguing passage to me can be found in Revelation chapter 21. Starting at verse 22, John the Apostle is calling our attention to the New Jerusalem. Now, I will quickly add that the interpretation of this passage is subject to various points of view. But he's describing the New Jerusalem. For, in perhaps popular terms, he's describing the New Heaven. And I saw no temple in the city, verse 22 of chapter 21, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine in it, for the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light will the nations walk, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. And its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. They will bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations. But nothing unclean will ever enter it, nor anyone who does what is detestable or false, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Now, this is subject to, as I said, varying interpretations, but I find it intriguing that in describing the eternal state, in describing the New Jerusalem, the apostle tells us that the glory of the nations will be brought into it. The best of all things that mankind has created, now in a more sanctified state, will be part of the glory that is the New Jerusalem. Now, I'm pointing this out because sometimes we limit ourselves in our worship of God because we limit ourselves to only those things that we think are in the Scriptures. And we do not give praise to God for His amazing grace in allowing us to live in an amazing world. Fallen though it is, there are things of great beauty, great art, great subjects of contemplation, and we should take advantage of it. Now, I'm going to make a few observations as we get into this chapter 2 of Deuteronomy. Paul indicates in chapter 11 of the book of Romans this truth. He says, "Note then the kindness and severity of God." The kindness and severity of God. Two aspects. Severity toward those who have fallen, but God's kindness to you, provided you continue in His kindness. Otherwise, you too will be cut off. This passage of chapter 2 of Deuteronomy presents us with what I'm going to call hard things. Now, one hard thing that's difficult to understand sometimes is the goodness of God. You say, well, I think I understand God's goodness. Yes, but sometimes we limit God's goodness to our own imaginations and our own thinking. The second hard thing has to do with God's severity. Both of those things are intriguing. Both of those things are hard to understand. But we are genuinely blessed when we seek to find out what God means here. When we are presented with hard things, and by hard things I mean things in Scripture that are hard to understand, things in Scripture that seem to go contrary to how we think, things that God has not chosen to explain in His fullness, when we're presented with those hard things, I think it's because God wants us, first of all, to learn how to think. He wants us to think about it. He does not want us to go into wild streams of imagination to seek to explain things that are inexplicable. But sometimes He presents us hard truths in the Scripture because He genuinely wants us to learn how to think, how to compare Scripture with Scripture, how to sanctify, in a sanctified sense, use holy and spirit-filled imagination to figure out what could God possibly be doing with us here. When presented with hard things, we have to think about them. And hard things sometimes teach us how to think. Have you ever been struck with the terms entertainment versus amusement? I think about this sometimes. There are some things that are genuinely entertaining, but entertainment has the idea of entree to attainment, that this thing may be enjoyable, it might be pleasurable, it might be thought-provoking, but the ultimate goal is that you learn something. You're attaining something. And as I've mentioned before, the opposite of that, well, not opposite, another shade of that is amusement, which literally means without thought. And this is why we call them amusement parks. All right, you get on the roller coaster and you're just brain dead for a while and you scream. And that's, it was fun, adrenaline rush. We get off and we go cool off by going through the water thing and splash water all over ourselves. It's just amusement. It's not meant to be entertaining. It's meant to simply cause you not to think anymore. And that's not the same thing as watching a really good comedy that was written by a great playwright, say Shakespeare, where the thing may be hilariously funny, but there's something to be attained. There's some aspect about human nature, the human predicament, what it's like to be human that the playwright is drawing on, and he wants us to think about it. And in that same vein, our Bible reading should not be amusement. It can be genuinely entertaining, but it's not supposed to be just amusing. There are things that God says that I sometimes find very funny. Do you ever laugh during your devotions? I find myself laughing, usually at myself, when I come across something. I came across one today in Sunday school class. I almost laughed out loud. In the plot to kill Jesus, it also says the Pharisees were attempting to kill Lazarus. Hey, he's already been dead once. That didn't work. You know. He's going to come back. So I know he rose from the dead. Let's kill him. Man, can anybody be any stupider than that? I can. So hard passages teach us to think. Hard passages also build our faith. We know from the outset, or we should know from the outset, that God is merciful, God is good, God is pure, and He cannot sin, and He cannot do anything contrary to His holy character. You have to posit that before you go into a hard passage. And God wants us to ponder, and He will reward pondering to build our faith. We've talked before about Jesus' inner circle, what we think of as His inner circle, of Peter, James, and John. And why does God seem to reveal more to them? Why does He give more answers to them? And the answer is fairly simple. They ask. They follow. They ask intriguing questions. Sometimes they ask dumb questions, but they keep asking. And Jesus reveals Himself to them in a more intimate way than He tends to reveal Himself to the other apostles, because they're curious. They're thinking about what He says. Hard sayings cause us to think. Hard sayings build our faith. And hard sayings keep us humble, because we sometimes come to the truth that there are secret things that belong to God, and they reveal things that belong to us. And hard sayings require that we be patient. Now, the book of Deuteronomy has hard sayings. There are things that take place in the book of Deuteronomy that seem so foreign to 21st century American living. There are aspects of God's judgment on people groups that we cringe at, frankly, because it seems so harsh. Well, He wants us to think. He wants our faith to be built. And He wants us to stay humble. Deuteronomy chapter 2. We'll read through the passage, and don't be afraid to read long passages in worship services. It's God's word, after all. The passage starts with one of the most sad, I think one of the saddest phrases in all the book of Deuteronomy. Then we turned and journeyed into the wilderness. Why is Moses recounting this? He's just finished in chapter 1 recounting the fact that God brought us to Kadesh Barnea. He asked us to enter the land, and because of faithlessness and because of fear, the people would not enter. The next chapter begins with, then we turned and journeyed in the wilderness, in the direction of the Red Sea. So we're looking at, if you're looking at a map, you're looking basically in a southeasterly direction. This is toward the southeast of what is, generically speaking, the Holy Land. And for many days we traveled around Mount Seir. Then the Lord said to me, you've been traveling around this mountain country long enough. Again, I laugh when I read that. Turn northward and command the people, you're about to pass through the territory of your brothers, the people of Esau, who live in Seir, and they will be afraid of you, so be very careful. Do not contend with them, for I will not give you any of their land, no, not so much as for the sole of the foot to tread on, because I have given Mount Seir to Esau as a possession. You shall purchase food from them with money that you may eat, and you shall also buy water from them with money that you may drink. For the Lord your God has blessed you in all the work of your hands. He knows you're going through this great wilderness. These 40 years the Lord your God has been with you. You have lacked nothing. So we went on, away from our brothers, to the people of Esau who live in Seir, away from the Arabah road, from Elath and Ezion-Geber. So the first people they encounter that the Lord is talking about would be the Edomites, another term for descendants of Esau. And as this passage recounts, I don't want you messing with these people. You're not going to conquer them. You're not going to fight them. You are very politely going to purchase from them food and water. And notice the reasoning the Lord has. I have given this land to Esau. I have given this land to a disobedient, wild donkey of a man who by faith sold his birthright. I've made a promise to him, and God doesn't break his promises. Even to people who don't know him, he does not break his promises. So they go on. And we turned and went in the direction of the wilderness of Moab. Well, who's Moab? You have Moab, the Moabites, and you have the Ammonites. These are, of course, descendants from Lot. You all remember the horrible story. After Lot left Sodom and Gomorrah, his wife turned back. She was turned to a pillar of salt. Lot is with his two daughters. They become so confused, they think, we're not going to have any descendants. We will be barren. We won't have any children. So they get their father drunk. They have sex with him, and two children are born, Moab and Ammon. And these are the descendants of these people. Once again, what does the Lord say? And the Lord said to me, do not harass Moab or contend with them in battle, for I will not give you any of their land for a possession, because I have given Ar to the people of Lot for a possession. A parenthetical starts at verse 10. The Emim formerly lived there, a people great and many, and tall as the Anakim. We have this Anakim, it comes from, you have various terms for them, such as the Rephaim. It basically means giants or scary ones, those who are really, really frightening people. They live there. Verse 11, like the Anakim, they are also counted as Rephaim, but the Moabites call them Emim. The Horites also lived in Seir formerly, but the people of Esau dispossessed them and destroyed them from before them and settled in their place, as Israel did to the land of their possession which the Lord gave them. End of parenthetical. What is happening here? And it's brought out later on in our passage. Just as God was going to dispossess certain people of the land so that the people of Israel could possess it, he dispossessed certain people of the land so that Esau's folks could have it. Not only did God promise the land to them, he gave the land to them and worked in advance in the same way that he was working in advance for the people of Israel. Verse 13, now rise up and go over the brook Zered. So we went over the brook Zered, And the time from our leaving Kadesh Barnea until we crossed the brook Zered was 38 years, until the entire generation, that is, the men of war, had perished from the camp as the Lord had sworn to them. For indeed, the hand of the Lord was against them, one of our hard sayings in a moment, to destroy them from the camp until they had perished. That generation who refused to go in, who were old enough to know better, they died in the wilderness. Moses goes on in his sermon, so as soon as all the men of war had perished and were dead from among the people, the Lord said to me, today you are to cross the border of Moab at Ar. And when you approach the territory of the people of Ammon, do not harass them or contend with them, for I will not give you any of the land of the people of Ammon as a possession, because I have given it to the sons of Lot for a possession. Verse 20 starts what I think is another parenthetical. When I say parenthetical, it seems like it may have been added by our chronicler at a later time. It may not be something that Moses said in this sermon, but was added by an inspired chronicler later on. It's difficult to know. It is also counted as a land of Rephaim. Rephaim formerly lived there, but the Ammonites call them Zabuzuzuzum. All right, lots of Z's, lots of M's. Right. A people great and many, and tall as the Anakim, but the Lord destroyed them before the Ammonites, and they dispossessed them and settled in their place, as he did for the people of Esau, who live in Seir, when he destroyed the Horites before them, and they dispossessed them and settled in their place even to this day. As for the Avim, who lived in the villages as far as Gaza, the Kaphtorim, who came from Kaphtor, destroyed them and settled in their place. Rise up, set out on your journey, and go over the valley of Arnon. Behold, I have given into your hand Sihon, the Amorite, king of Heshbon, and his land. Begin to take possession and contend with him in battle, not the other ones. But when we come to this group of Amorites led by Sihon, it's a different story in God's eyes. You do take the battle to them. This day I will put, I begin to put the dread and fear of you on the peoples who are under the whole heaven, who shall hear the report of you and shall tremble and be in anguish because of you. God is going to cause people to be afraid of Israel. So I sent messengers from the wilderness of Kedemoth to Sihon, the king of Heshbon. But notice, with words of peace. Moses isn't coming to them and saying, oh, God told us to wipe you out. He's saying, you have a chance. You have an opportunity. Treat us right. With words of peace saying, let me pass through your land. I will go only by the road. I will turn aside neither to the right nor to the left. You shall sell me food for money that I may eat, and give me water for money that I may drink. Only let me pass through on foot, as the sons of Esau who live in Seir and the Moabites who live in Ar did for me, until I go over Jordan into the land the Lord our God is giving to us. But Sihon, the king of Heshbon, would not let us pass by him. For the Lord your God had hardened his spirit and made his heart obstinate that he might give him into your hand as he is this day. More about that later. And the Lord said to me, behold, I have begun to give Sihon and his land over to you. Begin to take possession, that you may occupy the land. Then Sihon came out against us, he and all his people, to battle at Jahaz. And the Lord our God gave him over to us, and we defeated him and his sons and all his people, and we captured all his cities at that time and devoted to destruction every city, men, women, and children. Big time hard saying. Massive hard saying. We killed children. More about that later. We left no survivors. Only the livestock we took as spoil for ourselves with the plunder of the cities that we captured. From Aroer, which is on the edge of the valley of Arnon, and from the city that is in the valley as far as Gilead, there was not a city too high for us. The Lord our God gave all into our hands. Only to the land of the sons of Ammon you did not draw near, that is, to all the banks of the river Jabbok and the cities of the hill country, whatever the Lord God had forbidden us. Hard sayings. Sometimes the goodness of the Lord is a hard saying, but the goodness of the Lord reveals his mercy. Why would I say the goodness of the Lord can be a hard saying? Well, there's one that says it's a hard saying because God is good to bad people. These nations that he told the Israelites not to conquer and not to fight were not A1 elite Christian citizens of the land. These were pagan people. They were a vicious people, many of them, and by all accounts were not serving or worshiping the God of truth. But God was good to these people. God keeps his promises to bad people is another hard saying. Why would God keep his promises to people who don't love him? There's another hard saying about the goodness of God. The wicked people he blesses include Edomites, descendants of Esau, not good people. Esau was a bad man in many ways. Moabites, the descendants of Lot, while Lot was a righteous man who was vexed at his time, boy, his descendants were not righteous at all. Ammonites, again, descendants of Lot. But God still says about these peoples that he went before them and he gave them the land just as he did Israel. Does it sometimes trouble you that God is good to bad people? Do we not have a perverted sense of justice that says, wait a minute, everybody should get what they deserve? And this doesn't seem fair to us, folks. Let me give you a key biblical truth about this. You don't want fair. You absolutely don't want fair. Fair means all of us are in hell. That's what fair means. And you should rejoice in the mercy of God that he let these people live on, that some of them might happily find him, as Paul says in Acts. Yes, God's goodness to bad people is a mystery. It can be a hard saying, but we have to understand the mind of God as he reveals it. God has his reasons. He doesn't always tell us what they are, but that does not mean the reasons don't exist. And one of the reasons, according to Paul, is that God has established these habitations, God has established these borders, and God has poured out his rain on the just and the unjust because he's a merciful and good God. God gives people places to live, as Acts says, so that they might seek him. Again, Acts 17, let's repeat verse 26. And he made from one man every nation of mankind to live on the face of the earth, having determined allotted periods and boundaries of their dwelling place, that they should seek God and perhaps feel their way toward him and find him. God knows that these are a seeking people in some sense, but he also knows they're a blind people. It's like you're in total darkness. You can't see a thing. You're feeling your way along. Have you ever been in a dark cave? Turned off the flashlight? Dark. There's darkness, and then there's darkness. And in this case, these people are given enough light that they can find their way out to a certain extent. You say, what's a modern application of this? What is your attitude toward immigrants? Oh, don't get me started on immigration law. Don't get me started on the southern border. Okay, I will get you started on the southern border. We need reasonable and enforceable immigration laws, but has it ever occurred to us that God might be asking a people to find a better place where they might more likely be saved, where they might hear the gospel, where their basic human needs might be met in a better way? I tell you, if you ever travel to Central America and go to see the places where some of these people live, you then understand why they would go for hundreds of miles at the risk of life and limb and go across a border to try to find something better. Now, am I excusing illegal immigration? No. We do need reasonable and enforceable immigration laws. But sometimes Christians, I feel, myself included, we just don't look at this correctly. It could be that God is establishing a habitation so that people who aren't like us might find God. How is God good to the nations? He gives them places to live. He allows them to create great things. Are you glad that a guy named Jonas Salk actually created a vaccine? that rid the world for a large extent of polio? I don't know if Jonas Salk is a Christian man. I frankly probably doubt it. Mozart was one of the most profligate people you could ever imagine. And what glorious music he created, because God is good. A.W. Tozer did not have a formal education. He was poor, basically had a brief elementary education. He was so determined to learn the classics. He talks about kneeling and praying over Shakespeare that God might help him understand it. Shakespeare? Bah! Humbug. Last thing I did with my Shakespeare book is I threw it in the trash can on going out of the English class. Who needs it? Tozer thought he needed it. How about Cyrus? Cyrus is called my anointed, a pagan king that God says he uses. Are you seeing ways in which he even uses people like Nebuchadnezzar? And these often godless people, here's what makes us smile as Christians. They don't know that they're doing things to bring praise to the God that they probably hate. Isn't God great? Here's a bunch of people out there. They don't know me. They don't like me much. What they know about me, they reject. And I'm going to use that people to create great and wonderful things in the fields of art, science, mathematics, music, that are going to bring blessings to all kinds of people, including my own people. And I'm going to do it in spite of who they are, and I'm going to help all people and all mankind be elevated to a certain extent because a pagan group of people can create wonderful things. I just find that amazing. I hope you do too. And that brings us to Philippians 4:8. Do we really think and focus on those things which are elevating, those things which are beautiful, those things which are great, even if they were created by people who don't know the Lord? Why do we settle for a steady diet of mediocre Christian music when we have a wealth of great hymnody at our fingertips? Why do we content ourselves with bad, cheap sofa art when we have at our disposal beautiful works of creation and art that should uplift us? Have you been moved by a novel to the point of tears? When I read, and I've read it more than once, To Kill a Mockingbird, written by an unsaved woman, as far as I can determine, I'm moved to tears repeatedly. I have to put the book down and go think about it. I have to praise my God that this kind of prose could have been written to elevate my spirit and to give me a serious understanding of the human condition. Do the questions of the goodness of God sometimes pose themselves as hard sayings for you? And am I asking that you substitute the Word of God with any of these things? Absolutely not. I'm saying that as you go to the Word and as you live in this world, praise Him for the wonderful things that God is allowing to happen even in a fallen world. And when you think about this world and all the beauty that has been created by pagan people at times, can you think what that is going to look like when it is beautifully sanctified and brought into the New Jerusalem? How beautiful will it be? Even in the physical realm, when you go and see something so amazing as the Niagara Falls or the Victoria Falls or the Grand Canyon or any of the great wonders of the world, and you say to yourself, they're astoundingly beautiful, breathtakingly beautiful. What must they be like when the earth is restored and Eden is brought back? There is the goodness of God, but there's also the severity of God in this passage. Hard sayings. How about the saying that God was against his own people? That he worked against them at times. See, that's hard. I need to think about that. Why is God upset with his own people? He called them. He named them. He made promises to them. He's upset with them. He is working against them, ultimately for their own good. We know that. How about Moses can't go in? I mean, really, does that bother you? I mean, it's a hard saying. Folks, you come to some hard sayings. I mean, don't pretend that it doesn't bother you. That's one of my key points in this message. Don't pretend hard sayings don't bother you. Not hearing, put my fingers in the ears. It should bother you. You need to think about it. Here's Moses, the meekest man of all the earth, by the testimony of Jesus Christ. And he puts up with this recalcitrant people. And he puts up with them, and he puts up with them, and he puts up with them. And he has to go with them 40 years in the wilderness. Moses has to walk through the wilderness too. Not his fault. And then he's so frustrated, you know, God says, speak to this rock. Moses is so frustrated with these people. They're so backslidden. They're so ornery. They're so disobedient. Boom, I'm going to pound the rock. You can't go in now. Does that hard saying sometimes get next to you? Until you realize the holiness of God, the righteous standard of God, the message that it gives to us in terms of leadership, God expects us to obey. And we've got the really hard sayings that we're going to deal with in future sermons. And that is the killing of children, the wiping out of entire cities. Again, we're going to explore that later on. Suffice it to say here a few things. The battle is the Lord's. This has sometimes been called holy war. We don't use that term much anymore because of connotation. They're sometimes now called by theologians Yahweh wars. And by Yahweh wars, we mean the Lord is the commander. The Lord initiates the warfare. He selects the targets. He determines the strategy. It's God who's in control. Israel was God's instrument, but it is God who's gone to war against the Amorites. But we've got to be careful in our thinking. Sometimes we'll say, okay, you got these little children here. Just think what their lives are going to be like if they continue living as Amorites. And they're going to be brought up in paganism. Wouldn't it be better for them to just die now and go straight to heaven? Well, folks, that's what the abortionists say. Have you thought about that? If you really believe that, then you would not be against abortion, because I believe those babies are in the Lord's presence. Hard sayings should not turn us into idiots and cause us not to think. It's still a hard saying. God has his reasons, and he doesn't always choose to give us those answers. How about God hardening the Sion's heart? Is that a hard saying? It is. God hardens hearts by letting people do what they want to do. This is akin to how he worked with Pharaoh, right? Well, what's the problem here? The problem is men and women tend to worship themselves. The desire to have only what you want is tantamount to idolatry. It reveals that which we worship ourselves. All right, let's suppose I have a chalkboard behind me here and I ask you to tell me the worst people who ever lived. Let's do that. Who's the worst person to ever live? Give me a name. Judas. Did someone say Hitler? We always say Hitler. He's the gold standard of bad people. But if you name Hitler, if you name Mao Zedong, if you name any of the fascist leaders of World War II, what do they all have in common? They're autocrats. They rule themselves and accept no quarter from other people in terms of leadership. They are autocratic, the rule of one. And why are they autocrats? Because they are on the throne of their own universe, and they don't think God is there with them. God must do all that he can to overcome the pride in our lives. Because this is pride. And folks, the worst prayer you can pray before God is this: God, leave me alone. Because when God takes away his restraining mercy, when God takes away his restraining control, the entire universe is plunged immediately into utter hedonistic chaos. The world is a bad place, but believe me, it's a much better place than it could be because of the mercy of God in restraining his judgment. And folks, all you have to do, and all God has to do to utterly destroy you, is to give you what you want in the flesh. And that brings destruction. And that is the message of Romans chapter 1. Hard sayings that reflect sometimes God's goodness. Hard sayings that reflect sometimes God's severity. Can we draw a few lessons in our closing moments? God is merciful to people who don't love him, and we should be merciful to people who don't love him too. How quick we are to consign them to hell, where they are indeed going. How quick we are to be angry with them because they sin against God. The founder of the university where I graduated used to say, an apple tree isn't an apple tree because it grows apples. It grows apples because it is an apple tree. Sinners sin because they're sinners. Rebels rebel because they're rebels. And you sinned and you rebelled before God graciously saved you. God is merciful to people who don't love him. We should be too. And that includes merciful to people who don't love us. I like how Max Lucado puts this. Our Savior kneels down and gazes upon the darkest acts of our lives. But rather than recoil in horror, he reaches out in kindness and says, I can clean that if you want. And from the basin of his grace, he scoops a palm full of mercy and washes our sin. That's what he did for you, and that's what he can do for the nation. Another lesson is we should take advantage of the good things that sometimes bad people create. The same list of sins in Romans 1 that contains homosexuality also contains a little phrase that I find interesting. Disobedient to parents. Let me ask you, in terms of the judgment of God, and in terms of the catalogs of sins that the New Testament contains that indicate the lostness and depravity of human nature, have you ever disobeyed your parent in your life? I dare say no one in this room can say, I never, ever, one time disobeyed my parent. And if you could say that, have you ever been angry without cause? Have you ever been physically or emotionally out of control? Have you been prejudicial? Have you been angry? Have you ever gossiped? We can't do this by excluding sins that God links with what you all may think is the ultimate sin. If we held that as a standard, that any sinner whose sin is already in the catalog of sins can't produce something that we can be elevated by, then I think that is wrong-headed thinking. I'm sorry, perhaps I've gone too far here. I want to be cautious. But I'm telling you, God has made great and wonderful things available to us for our edification, and sometimes he's made those things from people who don't know him and who do not love him. And I believe he does it so that we can be elevated in our thinking as well. And that does not condone the sin or the lifestyle of the one who created it. Are you following what I'm saying here? God keeps his promises, and so should we. God is true to his promise. We need to be true as well. But also, we serve a merciful God who does all things well. And this is why the scripture says his plans are past finding out. I love the passage in Romans chapter 11. In Romans chapter 11, you have the culmination of a three-chapter sequence in which Paul is dealing with the Jews, and he's dealing with Israel. And particularly, he's dealing with Israel and their plan in the salvation events, their plan in redemption. And he makes some amazing statements. He basically says this. We're talking about the olive tree. And I have cut off the natural limbs of the olive tree because Israel has been disobedient. And I have taken you Gentiles and I have grafted you in as a horticulturalist would graft in a limb to that good branch, that good root, and you have flourished. And he says, you know what? I did this because now I want the natural olive branches to become jealous. And he says in the end day, he's going to save Israel in a day, and one of the reasons he's going to save them is because they're going to get jealous of what the Gentiles enjoy as being grafted in, and God is going to graft them in. And he basically says, if the wild branches can thrive, what will the natural branches be able to do? And then in Romans 11, 25 and 36, get this. Lest you be wise in your own sight, I do not want you to be unaware of this mystery, brothers. A partial hardening has come upon Israel until the fullness of the Gentiles has come in. And in this way, all Israel will be saved, as it is written. The deliverer will come from Zion. He will banish ungodliness from Jacob. And this will be my covenant with them when I take away their sins. God, I believe, still has a plan for ethnic Israel. As regards the gospel, Paul says, they are enemies for your sake. Paul had tremendous enemies, many of whom were Jews. But as regards election, they are beloved for the sake of their forefathers. God doesn't break his promises. For the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Or irrevocable. I think it's irrevocable. For just as you were at one time disobedient to God, now have received mercy because of their disobedience. So they too have now been disobedient, in order that by the mercy shown to you, they also may now receive mercy. For God has consigned all to disobedience, that he may have mercy on all. And then he says, it's like Paul comes to the end of himself, like I'm at the end of myself. Oh, the depth of the riches and wisdom of the knowledge of God, how unsearchable are his judgments, how inscrutable his ways. For who has known the mind of the Lord, or who has been his counselor, or who has given a gift to him that he might be repaid? The rhetorical answer is what? Nobody. And then he concludes, for from him and through him and to him are all things, to him be glory forever. Amen. Paul's basically having this resounding who'da thunk it moment. Can you imagine coming up with this plan? I will cast off my people temporarily. I will graft in a wild branch. They will flourish. That will cause jealousy among the native branches. They'll want to have what the Gentiles have. They're grafted back in. They flourish. All were consigned to disobedience. Now they're all my children, and Israel will be saved as in a day. Is this a great God or what? I mean, who'd have thunk this? Nobody would have thunk this. This great God poured out his severity, his divine wrath on his only son to demonstrate. You want the ultimate hard saying? The ultimate hard saying is this. Jesus Christ bore God's wrath. Jesus Christ paid the penalty. Jesus Christ suffered for 3 hours on the cross the hell that you deserve. To the point where he cries out, my God, why have you forsaken me? And then God uses that great redemptive act and he validates it by the resurrection from the dead. And then he goes about saving people by that message. Who'da thunk it? Who'da thunk it? A saved rebel people are we. But on the basis of grace, we've received his mercy. Folks, these are all hard truths that are difficult to grasp because God is so great and so deep and so wonderful. No one has been his counselor, and no one can give him a gift because they owe him something. There's a classic old hymn that's had some resurgence in recent days. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, writes Trevor Francis. Vast, unmeasured, boundless, free, rolling as a mighty ocean in its fullness over me. Underneath me, all around me, is the current of thy love, leading onward, leading homeward to thy glorious rest above. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus. Spread his praise from shore to shore. How he loveth, ever loveth, changeth never. nevermore. How he watches o'er his loved ones, died to call them all his own. How for them he intercedeth, watcheth o'er them from the throne. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, love of every love the best. 'Tis an ocean vast of blessing. 'Tis a haven sweet of rest. Oh, the deep, deep love of Jesus, 'tis a heaven of heavens to me. And it lifts me up to glory, for it lifts me up to thee. My friends, Jesus is all over Deuteronomy. He's everywhere. And when you see God show great mercy, it's a mercy that points to the mercy of the cross. When you see God show great grace, it's a grace that points to the graciousness of the cross. And when you see God forgive a willful, recalcitrant, rebellious people, it points to the salvation that we've all experienced. Because believe me, I know me, and I'm worse than any Amorite that ever lived. And God saved me, and I know because of that, he can save anyone by his mercy and by his grace. Let's pray. Father, your book is replete with some hard things, some that relate to your goodness, many that relate to your severity. But Father, you are an amazing, astounding, all-glorious God who knows the end from the beginning. And we thank you that we have been found in Christ before the foundation of the world. And we thank you that we've received great mercy. And we thank you that you have kept your promises to your people. Now, Father, we pray that we would go out and enjoy, in a worshipful sense, all the wondrous things you've created. May we marvel at the scientific breakthroughs that have helped so many people and healed so many diseases. May we be moved by great literature. May we be moved by great art, not because of the art itself, but because of the God who allowed it to be created and because of the uplifting of our souls and our minds. And Father, as we look into your word, show us these astounding truths. Show us those things that are beyond comprehension, and then give us a smidgen of ability to comprehend. And I pray, Father, that as we look into your word and as we see your astounding creations, may our minds and our hearts and our eyes be pointed to Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith, who for the joy that was set before him endured the cross, despised the shame, and is set down at your right hand. And because, Father, we know that of you and through you and to you are all things, may you be all in all to us through the mercy of Jesus Christ and through the power of the Holy Spirit. We beg in Jesus' name. Amen.